We all are born out of innocence. When I was a child, I was as innocent as everyone else. I had my fears, I had my inhibitions, I had my successes as well. I knew my strengths, I knew my weaknesses, and I was born without discrimination. I loved everybody. But as I grew up, I learned discrimination. Discrimination is something that you learn. Discrimination is not something that you're born with. When I grew up a little, when I was around 7 years of age, I was raped. I was raped by a male relative. And the rape continued till I was 18 years of age. When I was 12 years of age, I was gang raped. The abuser was a male relative. And it happened so often that if I was a woman, I would have been pregnant. Every time I was taken for a haircut by my uncle, after the haircut, I had to go to his house, and he never ever had to use pressure on me. I used to go into his house, remove my clothes, and lie down with my back facing him for him to do whatever he wanted to do. That was because at that young age, where I knew no hate, where I knew no discrimination, where I knew no anger, where I didn't know the meaning of anguish, where I was as pure with a heart that only knew love, my body was used, my body was abused, I was penetrated. When there were other boys in my class deciding what their homework schedule is going to be, I was more bothered about the stains, the blood stains that could come in my underwear, and that my mother would come to know what had happened to me. Where something so horrible was happening with you, but you weren't even aware that you were aware of something that was happening to you. That was my childhood. Where I was aware, but I was not aware that something was happening to me. And it's very difficult to explain in words or verses what exactly I was going through. And that too, I was a boy. Which simply means that boys are people who abuse. Boys aren't people who get abused. In fact, non-females don't get abused at all. That's what people believe. So, I was quiet. But there was disquiet within me. I was silent. But there was noise within me. The noise that never found a voice. But at these funny moments, you know, where you remember that song and you remember the lyrics, but you don't remember the whole song, there are these moments also where you'll remember the song and then you will forget the song. So there was this one moment where I told a very close friend. Again, I didn't have the power of language because we are in a country where we don't speak about sex, we only have a lot of sex. Because children are not born out of God. People have sex. And I'm sure that none of your parents are virgins who are watching this on TV, or none of y'all over here. They all had sex. But we just feel way too ashamed to admit to it. And in a space where we don't speak about sex, you don't speak about sexual organs, you don't know how to communicate. A child who's going through child sex abuse is not powered with the power of language for him or her or him to come out and say that, you know what, this person came and touched my penis. This person inserted his penis in my anus. You don't have the power of language. So as a child, I communicated to my friend as much as I could communicate at that age. And my friend didn't understand. My friend just said, he was again of my age. His understanding would be just as much as my understanding. So when I told him that my uncle touches me here and there, he just said it happens with everyone. And I was quiet and I thought that, okay, that's it. I didn't speak about it once again. And when I saw that there were boys in my class who were sexually aroused, who used to speak or in a sexual overtone, I thought that, hey, probably something like this is happening to them. I didn't remember which thing was happening to them, but I knew something was happening to them. Then I grew up. Again, I had a moment when I went, I was close to my mother, and I told my mother, "Mummy, I'm bleeding from my anus." My mother said, "You're eating too many mangoes." Ma kasam. I stopped eating mangoes for a year after that. But yes, I did lead into temptation and I started eating mangoes after that. But that 1 year was like, mangoes became an alibi, because otherwise my mother would have questioned me. And I would have told my mother what happened to me. What doesn't stop intensifies if you don't stop it at the right time. When I was 12, I started getting gang raped. My uncle started getting people home, one after the other. They all used to have sex with me. I used to bleed from my anus. They used to force me to have oral sex with them. And when I used to perform oral sex on them, sometimes it was my own blood that I used to suck off their penises. I know it's disturbing, but I want each one of you to hear this. I'm speaking so that your child doesn't have to. Don't make them. They don't need this podium. They don't need to be an inspiration, because I am willing to strip myself and show you my wounds. And then I grew up further. I did try telling my mother once again that my uncle touches me here and there. And my mother said, "Hey, don't go close to your uncle. Or just tell him that I don't like you touching me over there." Again, I thought that my mother didn't believe me. My mother didn't trust me. My mother didn't know what I was going through. And my mother didn't find it important to even probe me. All my school life, I was bullied. Because I used to walk a little differently. How do you walk when you're bleeding? How do you walk when you have someone pounding on you one night before? How do you sit on a wooden bench when the place where it hurts the most is your anus? I went through that. I lived in dramatics. My biggest dream all through my childhood was that I am looking in front of my own image in front of a mirror. And I'm telling my name to my own self, because I didn't have the courage to look at myself in the mirror and spell out my own name. But today, I dare to tell my name. My name is Harish Iyer, and I am a survivor of child sex abuse. The shame is not for me to keep. The shame is for my abusers, and I own every part of my body. When I grew up, when I was around 18 years of age, I was still getting abused, still living in this duality. I knew for sure that when I was around 14 years of age, you know, your hormones start doing tata taya within your body, and you know that you're feeling towards a particular gender or a particular sex. I knew that I was feeling sexual towards men. But I hated myself for it, because I was feeling sexual towards the same sex that had abused me. I used to hate men. I never liked men. I never went inside a gent's urinal simply because I had to encounter other men over there. All my friends were women. So that boy went from school. He moved to college. He faced another trauma. I wasn't even aware many a times of what was happening to me, because I used to blank out, and my reality used to come to me in the form of nightmares. I used to bedwet. Now, when I was in from school, when I went to college, that one friend that I opened up to in school, that one friend was in the same college as me. And that friend, you know, when you just have that one friend who knows your secret, that friend becomes the most important friend in your life. So he was very close to me, no denying that. And one day when I walked inside college, I had a group of people coming close to me, and when I went to say hi, they tell their friend, because they were in a group, don't speak to him, he has slept with a man. So I did what Hindi film heroines do. I rushed to the loo, I took a blade, I slashed my wrist. I survived. Because even if you're given one moment to think, you run to dear life. The second time I tried consuming tablets, I slept for 14 hours and then I woke up. I survived. And one day, in my life, came a dog. His name is Jimmy. I was very scared of animals. Very, very, very scared of animals. I remember the first time that Jimmy, a small German Shepherd pup, came into my life. The dog was behind me and I was up the tree and I was wearing a lungi at that time. I gave a free show to everybody. But I got down, Jimmy was waiting there to lick me, to accept me as his own. That's where my friendship began. That's where my opening up began. I started speaking to Jimmy. I started telling Jimmy, Jimmy, you know what? Today my uncle touched me here. Today, you know what? There were four people. Today there were five people. They did this to me. You know what? I'm bleeding. It aches. It pains. I started opening up to my dog, and you know what my dog did? Every time I spoke to him, he pounced on me, he ensured that I come down to his eye level, and every time I cried, he licked my tears. And that strength that no God but my dog gave me is the reason why I'm standing today and I'm telling you my story. I started speaking up, speaking to different people, and it started in my college. One day I was in college, I went on stage, I was standing like this because I used to be good in dramatics. I was there, I was playing a character, and the moment I went on stage, all kinds of swears started coming in. Gay, homo, baila, faggot, all kinds of swears. But this time, things were a little different. I didn't have God with me, I had dog with me. With the strength that Jimmy gave me, I went close to the mic and I said, I was 7 years of age when I was sexually abused, and at seven I enjoyed it. I switched off the mic, I threw the mic in the audience and I ran to the restroom where I just splashed water in my eyes because I wouldn't stop crying. This was the first time that I cried publicly about my abuse. So I walked out, I was escorted to the stage, and the same crowd that bullied me gave me a standing ovation. And then my college ensured that I take this tale to everyone in the college. So I started speaking right from the non-teaching staff to the teaching staff, to the watchmen, to students, to the new joinees, to the old joinees, to everybody. So that no one else gets bullied the way I got bullied. I wasn't even sure about my sexuality. I just knew that when Tarzan and Jane were there, I used to wait for Jane to go off the screen. That's one half of my story. Then I had to confront my sexuality. So I had a girlfriend like everyone else in my class. Our affair was the longest affair that I've ever had with a woman. It lasted for 1 week. I did have sex with a commercial sex worker, a woman. It was a one-night stand and it didn't stand at all. And that's when I decided that I need to come up and speak up for what I am. If I deny my right of my sexuality, eventually I would get married to a woman, and the woman has the right to her body as much as the man has the right to his body. The woman has the right to her sexuality and pleasure as much as the man has the right to his sexuality and pleasure. And I knew that, and I didn't want to force myself on anyone just because I wanted to fit into the norms of the society. This is my normal. The normal is that I'm gay. And I'm gay because I'm gay because I'm gay. Not because I didn't have any other way. Not because I was sexually abused by a man. There are 54% of men who get sexual, boys who get sexually abused in this country. And most often the abuser is a man. So if 54% of boys get sexually abused, are 54% of us gay? We are not. And does every woman who's heterosexual blame her heterosexuality on her abuse? Because there's hardly anyone who has not got sexually abused or touched or felt. So I'm not the consequence of something, of an incident, or even a gene. My sexuality is the essence of who I am. When I come here, I don't leave my gay back home. I carry it along with me. And whether you like it or not, you will have to accept me the way I am, because I am what I am. I know one question that is raging in your minds when you hear this story. What happened to my abuser? I'm 39 right now. I was raped when I was 18, 21 years before. That was the last I was raped. So there was no law. The POCSO, Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act, came into existence in 2012, recently. And by the time I was 18, I could be tried under Section 377. But I was an adult by then. There was no concept of consent over there. So there was no law. So the only thing that I could do is speak about it. Speak about it and keep speaking about it, because every time I spoke to an audience, at least 50 to 70% of the audience came back to me and told me that they knew of somebody that who had gone through something like this. After 10 conversations, you would discover that it's they themselves. I've spoken to around 5 lakh survivors from across the world. My number is Googleable. I attend these calls. And that's because I'm not broken because of hate. I've overcome because of love. The love that I have for myself, and more importantly, the love that I have for my dog. Recently, I did meet one of my gang rape, when they were doing the gang rape thing, one of my abusers. His son had died. And the last call dialed on his son's phone was mine. So he met me in this thing. I didn't recognize him, and he met me in a station, and he told me, "Do you remember this child?" I said, "Yes, I remember this child." And then he asked me, then he told me, and then he started crying. So I thought that he was a survivor, and I started hugging him. And then he told me, "Look, you didn't recognize me. I've just got the punishment for all the sins I've committed." And then when he looked at me, I didn't recognize him even then. He told me that he had raped me. So I told him, "Uncle, this is a train. Please go. And this is my number. Please call me tomorrow." The next day, when he called me, I met him at a railway station. I took him to a psychologist. He's broken. What do I achieve by breaking someone who's broken? I think the guilt, the anger, if it can be utilized, if it can be used in a constructive way, we could do much more good. That abuser of mine came out to his family, and he told his family that he had sexually abused me. He insisted that I take him to the police. I refused to take him to the police. I asked him if there were other victims. He said there were no other victims. So I took it on myself that I would spend time with him so that he doesn't break down and use any of his forces negatively from now. He's a wealthy man. He has contributed huge sums of money. Huge sums of money in crores for the awareness on child sexual abuse. And the reason why he could do that is because I stood with him and I told him it's okay. So we all have a past, some challenging part in our past. I know my story is something, you have rape and you have all these things, so you might feel that my story is one of the most challenging ones. The truth is that we all have gone through something or the other in our lives that sets us back, that pushes us behind. But accept every part of your story. Don't deny the right of your past. Don't deny yourself the right of your past. But remember to park your past in the past. Just borrow from that, let it energize you, and then park it back over there. Imagine that you're closing it. So, the person who is standing in front of you is the person who used to get scared to tell his own name. And today I'm telling you, my name is Harish Iyer. And yes, I am a survivor of child sex abuse. Yes, I am a homosexual. Yes, I have filed an impeachment application in the Supreme Court, and one of the reasons why we have the verdict, one of the many reasons, there are many activists who have worked on it. One of the reasons why POCSO also has a provision, POCSO, Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act, also is gender neutral. One of the many reasons, all the males who have spoken up, all the people from other genders who have spoken up. I am what I am. Take me as I am. Because I don't know any other way to be. This is the best I can be. I own every cell of my body and every story of my life. And I want each one of you who's either watching this or who's listening to this right now to understand that you and you alone are the God of your story, no one else. Or better still, you and you alone are the dog of your story and no one else. Just as my dog was for me, if you know of someone who is a survivor of child sex abuse, who has been through any hardship, it might not be abuse, it might not be rape, it might be financial difficulty, or their boyfriend leaving them, or girlfriend leaving them, or professor cribbing every time, or their friends getting more marks than them, anything, be a dog to them.